So I think there are very good examples of CMOs. I have not come across customers who are competing, who are deciding between, say, India and Brazil in CMOs. I don't see them as a big competitor to even the CMO space. I think coming to Russia, yes, definitely a lot of library skills, lots of dollars going into nanotechnology. I don't know enough about nanotechnology to be able to comment, but definitely they have a lot of library skills, and they make a lot of, there are a lot of companies that have compounds on the shelf that they can sell. Coming to India, I think the strategy, you said the strategy for China was around chemistry. I think the other benefit for China is possibly in animal testing and animal models, where India seems to be a little challenged only because of ethical issues, etc. But I think the strategy for India is going to evolve as follows. One is innovation in discovery, and number two is integration of CRO with CMO and CRAMS business, contract research and manufacturing all in one. I think these are the two things I see as some of the larger CROs evolving into.
I think one of the big differences, one of the key differences, I think, between a very successful outsourcing business in India, which has been IT and BPO, and a business like pharma, is that in the pharma, the scale that we're talking about is a minute fraction of what it is in IT. So looking to scale business by volume is probably not going to play out very much, because I think we pretty much have seen as much outsourcing as possible. Maybe it'll go up, it'll double in size from here, but it still would be insignificant. The turnover of all the CROs in India put together is less than the quarterly profit, not profit, I mean a daily profit of an Infosys or something like that. I mean, it's just not even on the map when you talk about scales like that. So I think if you take the opportunity going forward, it can only be from, there's no competition only in one area, which is innovation. You can innovate and create value. Actually, finding the right niche, finding the right opportunities for innovation is the only viable option going forward. Most of the businesses, if they become a leverage of cost being the core advantage, then I think the scale is so small in this business that there's really no play out there. Because the only scale-based play here is in clinical development, which spends much more money. There's much more money spent on clinical development than there is in early discovery. So if we leave the clinical research market out of our discussion for now, I think the only way we can see growth and value is from innovation, on which I completely agree with Mani.
I can't profess that I know a lot about all these markets beyond India and China, but also from basically my readings and some of the feedback from industry veterans. You know, each of these countries follow a little bit of a different path. I'm surprised you mentioned that chemistry is what's driving China, because, again, India has been probably historically much more strong in the chemistry space and in chemical engineering. And therefore, as Mani was saying, the number of plants with FDA approvals for generic as well as, APIs and generics, that I think we are a significant player in that field. I think where India has not done that well is in the area of biologicals, biotechnology products. There are some companies that have, again, done well, but much less so. I think China has been more successful so far in building more capabilities in biologicals. So India and China being the nearest competitors in terms of, large populations, lots of very skilled people. I think in the world stage, among the four BRIC nations, these two probably are most significant. Russia and Eastern Europe, again, after the breakup of the Soviet Union, these countries all have taken different approaches in terms of how they service this industry. I think there has been a lot of government laboratories that were there from the pre-Soviet days, and a lot of that were accessible to people. So what I have come across are that, you know, a few years ago, that the Eastern European nations were able to compete much better in pricing compared to us because of the capital cost was basically subsidized. They have created a couple of very strong, you know, proprietary library companies, as we know, like Asinex and others. And they have done a good job in terms of creating, you know, significant operations in that arena. Don't know much about Brazil, but I would imagine that, you know, a lot of their future growth will be driven, again, through, you know, innovation like India is, because to start with, they haven't had a very strong industry in the pharma space. So I think, you know, we are one of the players in this game. I think when we talked about where we can add value, you know, we need to really have success stories coming out of India. And in that arena, we are all together. You know, if one company fails, then all of us are looked up as failures. So I think, you know, there's a lot on our plate here in India that differentiates us from others that we need to really work on.
No, I think we'll move from the India-China discussion, because it's been quite some time we have spent on this particular topic, you know. So if there's something else which anyone wants to add above, you know, apart from India-China, because there are certain other things I would like to touch in the course of the discussion. So maybe one last thing.
Yeah. And biotech counterpart on the other hand. Now let's say, since this BioAsia, with specific example to vaccines. Now you have typhoid vaccine, which is available in India and of course worldwide. But then the conjugate vaccine in typhoid is not yet available. I'm sure companies are working on that. Now my question was, do CROs, and as a representative of the CRO industry, what is the take of the panel? Would you sort of identify such business opportunities, work on that, and make a sort of pre-formulated technology available and say, well, any company, whether biotech or pharma, can come up, partner, and there comes a new molecule. So are the early stage kind of candidates being worked backwards, looking at the market, or is it Suomoto something which is going on?
Let me rephrase it to the approval stage. Nowadays, there is a lot of things where the pharma company or biotech company is saying, okay, hey, you do everything from a conception to an approval stage. Vis-a-vis, we are also seeing certain CROs which are getting themselves as niche areas, let's say oncology or pediatrics or probably vaccines. So where do you see the real growth? Is it growth opportunities for both? If yes, then what are the areas, you know, the niche can be created?
Can I intervene here? I would like to make a correction there. There is already a conjugate typhoid vaccine on the market, developed by an Indian, small Indian company.
It's a very valid point. I mean, the example apart, I think, from the point of view of the issue that is brought up, which is there any innovation that is being attempted for India based on specific needs that we have here? Unfortunately, at Origin, we have not focused on the vaccine space, so we do not have anything like that. And in the pharma space, I think, I don't know if anybody would you know, disagree with me, but I think it would be hard to actually think of an India-specific program and trying to do a discovery through development for India, because the costs versus the size of the market, that equation does not quite add up. But I know that it could be very different in other areas like vaccines, where the costs are probably not in all instances as much as they are with pharma. So by default, I think we look at where the biggest value is. It happens to still be the big Western markets. So most opportunities are focused around where viable market opportunities are coming up. And the second part, as you have asked, I think if I were to look at breadth versus depth, I think as